The news that President Trump last June nearly fired the special counsel Robert Mueller has revived interest in a pair of bills that would prohibit Mr. Trump from firing Mr. Mueller without good cause. The president's recent attacks on the FBI, which seem intended to pave the way for Mr. Mueller's ouster by putting his Russia inquiry under a cloud of suspicion, make the case for the bills even stronger. But Republicans still resist. They want to contain the Russia investigation and worry that any concession to the Democrats will instead bolster its credibility. They have tried to mask these partisan motivations with constitutional objections to the bills. It is important to understand why those arguments are specious. For context, one must go back to 1973, when Richard Nixon fired the special prosecutor Archibald Cox rather than turn over the Watergate tapes. The country was thrown into a political crisis, driven by uncertainty about how far Nixon would go to protect his presidency. Congress eventually responded with the Ethics in Government Act of 1978. This law created what came to be known as the Independent Counsel, who was given the power to investigate the president and his aides if they were suspected of wrongdoing. The Independent Counsel was appointed by judges, not removable by the president, removable by the Attorney General only for cause, and further insulated with an independent budget. Years later, a Reagan administration official, Theodore Olson, was the target of an independent counsel investigation. Mr. Olson argued at the Supreme Court that the independent counsel's office unconstitutionally infringed on the president's executive power. In 1988, the court rejected this argument over the lone dissent of Justice Antonin Scalia, who argued that politically motivated witch hunts would be the result of an independent counsel outside the control of the president. Justice Scalia's dissent, ignored at the time, has since emerged as a talisman for deflecting challenges to executive authority. After the out-of-control Kenneth Starr investigation, which led to President Bill Clinton's impeachment, Justice Scalia's criticisms of the law seemed prescient, and Congress let the law lapse in 1999. Mr. Mueller thus operates under Justice Department regulations. Justice Scalia argued that the law creating the independent counsel was unconstitutional because the Constitution gives the president alone the executive power. The executive power includes law enforcement actions like investigation and prosecution, and so the president must have complete authority over all subordinates who engage in law enforcement. Republican critics of Mr. Mueller have repeated this impressive-seeming syllogism like a mantra. If they are right, a law granting the special counsel for cause job protection would be unconstitutional. But the argument does not bear scrutiny. James Madison never argued for a complete separation of powers. He believed that the powers needed to be partly mixed so that the branches could restrain one another. That's why the president has, for example, the veto, a legislative power since it influences legislation. Congress was given the authority to create offices in the executive branch, which necessarily gives it control over the executive branch. And that's the story behind the Necessary and Proper Clause, which gives Congress power to make sure the government operates properly. Much of the executive branch is the product of Congress's legislation, including nearly all of the offices and the powers and responsibilities of the office holders. Civil service protections limit executive power, so do reporting requirements, and even for cause limits, upheld by the Supreme Court, on the president's power to remove high-level executive branch officials like the governors of the Federal Reserve Board and the members of the Federal Trade Commission. And practices in the era of the founders did not reflect Justice Scalia's views. Federal law enforcement powers were exercised in the early years of the country by federal and state officers not under the supervision of the president and even by private citizens. In 1978, Congress believed that an independent counsel was necessary and proper for preventing the president from breaking Congress's laws. Congress rejected what would be Justice Scalia's main line of attack that because the people can punish at the polls a president who abuses his powers, an independent counsel is unnecessary. President Nixon's illegal surveillance of the Democratic National Committee was aimed at preventing voters from making an informed choice in the 1972 election. The firing of Archibald Cox took place in Nixon's second term, so voters could hardly punish the president by voting him out of office. And while the threat of impeachment finally forced Nixon to resign, it was the work of the special prosecutors, Cox, and then his replacement, Leon Jaworski, that paved the way. The majority in the Supreme Court had no trouble rejecting Justice Scalia's arguments, which were palpably absurd in the wake of Watergate. Now that we have a president who poses the greatest threat to constitutional norms since Nixon, Congress needs to rediscover its constitutional responsibilities. It should pass a bill that grants the special counsel for cause protection against firing by the president, and it should do so before it's too late.